one more week in our This Means War series, and we'll move on to our Christmas series. It's going to be called the Christmas Family Reunion. It's been a good one, and we're going to conclude today talking about the battleground or the battle for our families. Thanksgiving right around the corner. It's time for us to stop for a minute and reflect on our family and all the blessings that we've had and all just the good time. Just enjoy each other's company. But today we talk about the fact that the family unit in our society is very much under attack. Do you agree with that? Here's how we know. Actually, there's been a little bit of a decline in the divorce rate here in recent years, but there's been a rise of single-parent homes. Less folks are getting married these days. More kids are growing up without both parents. And so we have definitely a different, and we have less stable family structures in our country, in our society today. On top of that, man, we're all so busy. Everyone is super busy in the world that we live in. We all work a lot. There's not much time left for our families. And add in social media and TikTok and flipping through little videos all the time. That stuff just vies for our attention so much. And family quality time is at a premium. That's why we enjoy Thanksgiving. Because we get a little bit of that, right? The question of what even a family is in our society is being questioned. What is a family? Is it what the Bible says a family is? Or is it defined by groupthink and the way social media and talking heads and influencers around us say it is? The ideal of family is greatly being devalued in our culture. We've got gender wars, gender roles, homosexuality, transgenderism, feminism, and other things that have all taken a toll on the traditional family unit. Now, I'm just going to tell you, I'm going to get a little bit up in your Kool-Aid this morning. Is that all right? I'm going to get a little up in your turkey and your dressing and whatever else you like to eat on Thanksgiving. My goal is not to offend you. My goal is to tell you the truth. And if the truth offends you and it comes from the Word of God, then maybe you should listen to God. Say all this with the caveat that we love you. And God loves you no matter where you are right now and what you've done. See, families are the foundation. They always have been. They're the foundation of our communities. Each family, if you think about it, is kind of like a small little community of its own. Inside the family, we learn the basics. We learn how to act. We learn what's right and we learn what's wrong. We learn the best ways to treat each other. When families are healthy and when they instill strong values, these qualities ultimately flow into the larger community, which makes it stronger and more positive. But when families are destroyed, children grow up and learn morals from things like TikTok. And that ain't good. I saw this week that there's some folks on TikTok that are saying, well, you know what? I think Osama bin Laden actually had a point whenever they destroyed the Twin Towers and all those things on 9/11. He actually had a pretty good point. Are you kidding me? No, he didn't. A generation is learning values and things like that from social media, not in the family unit, the way God designed. And I would tell you that the breakdown of the family is at the root of most, if not all, of the significant problems that we face in our culture today. School shootings, that's a terrible thing. I'm so thankful that we haven't had that happen here in our little small area just yet. But the tragedy of school shootings, they often stem from the family breakdown. Most shooters come from homes that are unstable or abusive or even absent family relationships. There's nobody to help them learn how to address those issues of mental health, and there's nobody to help them understand what's right and what's wrong. Oftentimes, these shooters are people that feel isolated. And this contributes to the behavior that they ultimately do that destroys people's lives, communities, and families in school shootings. Also, substance abuse. We've got a big issue with substance abuse in our country, in our area today. Why is that happening? I would tell you that the rise in drug and alcohol abuse can be right directly attributed to family issues. When children grow up in homes with substance abuse, neglect, or lack of guidance, they are more likely to turn to drugs and alcohol as coping mechanisms. Also have a big rise of mental health issues in our society today. You hear that term all the time, and it's real. We believe, church, in the country, in mental health issues. We believe those are real issues that people face. These increasing mental health problems, especially amongst many young people, can be linked to the disintegration of the traditional family. When family support is lacking, individuals, particularly children and teenagers, may struggle with feelings of abandonment, low self-esteem, which ultimately will lead to things like anxiety and depression and other mental health challenges. How about crime? Crime in our culture, you can link it directly to the destruction of the family unit in our country. Absent or ineffective parental guidance often leaves young people without a clear understanding of right and wrong. And so we see crime. And lastly, poverty and economic struggles. So many single parent homes often result in limited resources, which means that these families face significant challenges in providing for their children. There's no stable family structure, very limited educational and job opportunities, and it creates a cycle of poverty that's very difficult to break. All these things can be traced back to the breakdown of the family in our society. Now, I know most of us would love to see this turn around. And the reality is, none of us here, myself included, can make it change on a corporate level, but we can make a difference in our own families. We do have the ability to make changes. It will start with us. If we want to see the family unit become strong in our communities, in our society, in our culture, once again, it's going to start right here and right there in your families. There is a battle going on for the family in our world. And thankfully, the Lord has not left us defenseless. We're going to read one more time Ephesians 6, and we're going to be done with this passage for a little while. But God tells us, and Paul tells us in verse 13 of Ephesians 6, that we should put on all of God's armor so that we'll be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the devil. For we're not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so that you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground by first putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet, and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. We're all in a battle for our family this Thanksgiving 2023. And it is a battle that's worth fighting. And it's one that we need to win for so many reasons, as we have previously stated. This morning, I want you to see how you can win this battle for your family with the armor that God has given us. Today, we look at a guy who was successful in winning the war, winning the fight for his family in a society that possibly had a lot in common with ours. Turn to Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 this morning, and we'll find the story of this guy, a guy you've probably heard of before. Genesis 6, verse 5. The word says that the Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth. And he saw that everything that they thought or imagined was consistently and totally evil. So the Lord was sorry, gosh, he had ever made them and put them on the earth. It broke his heart. And the Lord said, I will wipe this human race I've created from the face of the earth. Yes, I will destroy every living thing, all the people, the large animals, the small animals that scurry along the ground, and even the birds of the sky. I'm sorry I even made them. In verse 8, but Noah found favor with the Lord. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a what? A righteous man. The only blameless person living on the earth at the time. And he walked in close fellowship with God. Now, Noah's story took place long before the armor of God was described in Ephesians 6, but it will serve this morning as a powerful example of how we can live out the principles, especially in the context of protecting and caring for our families that we find in Ephesians chapter 6 in the armor of God. So this morning, we're going to look at how we can follow Noah's footsteps and apply the armor of God to our family lives. First off, I would tell you that the way that Noah fought and won for his family in the midst of a corrupt culture, in the midst of a culture that God was about to wipe off the face of the earth, is that Noah embraced God's truth in the middle of all this junk going on. He put on the belt of truth. He did. We must, folks, ground our families in the truth. This means that we must teach our families. We must believe as families together in the principles and the values that we find in God's word. It certainly will not be popular. People will look at us like we're crazy. It will be countercultural. But don't be afraid. Have some guts. Have some guts. I think Noah next put on the breastplate of righteousness, or the body armor of righteousness. The word says that Noah was a righteous man, which ultimately was what led to his protection and his ability to protect his family from the flood. Look at Genesis chapter 6, verse 17. Look at what it says. Look, God says, I'm about to cover the earth with a flood that will destroy every living thing that breathes. Everything on earth will die, but I will confirm my covenant with you, Noah. So enter the boat, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. If it wasn't for Noah's righteousness, he would have been swept away in the flood like everyone else. You know, it's important that in our family structures, in our homes, that we create an environment where moral values thrive. We need to show our family and show our children and our grandchildren how Jesus would act. We need to make good choices. We need to teach our kids about right and about wrong. All of these things, the fact that Noah lived this way, his righteousness protected him and his family from a discipline of the Lord. Side note, parents, families, discipline your kids now so God won't have to do it for you later, because he will. And it's probably going to be a lot worse than a spanking on the behind. He may do it anyways. Noah, on some level, pleased God by living a moral life. But don't get it twisted. Noah was not perfect either. And as you hear this word today, you will probably look at the standard that's set in this message, and you will see yourself falling under that. I'm not doing that. I'm not. I haven't done all these things correctly. Listen, Noah didn't either. He wasn't perfect. Look at the little situation that happened after the flood. Pretty interesting. Let's read it real quick. Genesis chapter 9, verse 18. This is after the flood had occurred, and they were rebuilding and restarting over. The word says that the sons of Noah who came out of the boat with their father were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham is the father of Canaan. From these three sons of Noah came all the people who now populate the earth. After the flood, Noah began to cultivate the ground, and he planted a vineyard. Check this out. One day, He drank some wine he had made, and he became drunk and laid naked inside of his tent. Ham, the father of Caden, saw that his father was naked and went outside and told his brothers. Then Shem and Japheth took a robe, held it over their shoulders, and backed into the tent to cover their father. As they did this, they looked up from the other way so that they would not see him naked. When Noah woke up from his stupor, he learned what Ham, his youngest son, had done. Then he cursed Canaan, the son of Ham. May Canaan be cursed. May he be the lowest of servants to his relatives. Listen. We all got some family drama. That was embarrassing. Yeah. Like, I'm embarrassed for Noah right now, reading this thing thousands of years later. Like, we all got some family drama. Some of us have a lot of awkward tension in our families. Some of us have done some really dumb stuff. Some of us have totally blown it, especially in the area of how we relate to our families. Some of us have hurt our families. Noah did. He did. First off, he got drunk and naked and laid there. So embarrassing. And then, after that, he punished one of his sons for really no reason. Like, you can read that and you look at why did Noah curse his son? Well, there's a lot of different schools of thought and a lot of different opinions on why he did that, but really nobody knows. He may have just reacted in a bad way. All of us have done things that we regret. We have. Listen, find forgiveness from God. Start today and move forward in your life, in your family life. His grace is enough. Noah was better than everyone else in God's eyes, but he still blew it. But thank God for Jesus and his righteousness that covers us. And today, in your family, you have an opportunity for a second chance and a fresh start. No matter where you are or what you've done or how your family treats you right now and how you treat them. The next thing Noah did was he picked up his shield of faith. Can't you imagine as God began to tell Noah to build this big, huge ark? That thing was massive. It was huge. You guys, some of you have probably been to the ark exhibit up there in Kentucky and seen the replica of that thing. Can't you imagine how crazy people thought that he was whenever he did that? We don't have any biblical evidence that he faced ridicule and those kind of things, but common sense would just say, you know what? People thought Noah was nuts. And you can't blame him. The earth had never flooded before. Not even sure that it maybe had even rained before. Maybe it had. But this was a foreign thing for these people. And they already think Noah is crazy enough because he doesn't live the way they live. And now all of a sudden, he's building this gigantic boat on dry land. Wow. He had to have faced a lot of ridicule. How did he do it? He did it because he picked up his shield of faith. Because he had faith. All the mockery, the skepticism, the things that were coming his way, he was able to persevere and continue on with what God had told him to do. Similarly, we can uphold faith in our families. Let me ask you this question. Where are you trusting God in your family? Where are you trusting God together in your family? Where do you have faith in your family? Think about it. Where have you stepped out and shown your family that you do have faith? Where have you brought your family in something? Some of us have kids, we have children, we have an opportunity to model this in front of our kids. And there's so many different ways that it can happen. Maybe somebody's sick. Hey, we're going to believe together. We're going to have faith that God's going to take care of that. Amen. That God's going to heal. Amen. Or maybe it's a situation in your life that's not going good. Maybe it's a financial thing. Maybe the reality is some of us need to have an honest conversation with the people that we love and tell them what it is. Instead of trying to act like it's not really happening. No, we're going to talk about the fact that it's happening. But we're going to trust God, and we're going to watch God work in the area of our life that we're struggling in. Where are you picking up the shield of faith in your family today? The next thing that Noah did was he picked up or put on the shoes or the boots of the gospel of peace. Look at Genesis 7, verse 17. We see the flood happening for 40 days. The flood waters grew deeper and they covered the ground and it lifted the boat high above the earth. As the waters rose higher and higher above the ground, the boat floated safely on the surface. Finally, the water covered even the highest mountains on the earth, rising more than 22 feet above the highest peaks. The flood grew for 40 days and 40 nights, and the water covered the earth, folks, for 5 months. You know, we've been through some stuff here in our neck of the woods. Hurricanes, Hurricane Harvey, tornadoes, other things like that. But I don't think any of us have ever experienced anything like this. Can you imagine? We can kind of relate after going through some of these storms. We know the feeling of helplessness, right? When potentially everything that we have is about to be destroyed. When we're going to have to start all over. When we're going to have to rebuild our lives and rebuild our families. We understand. Some of you can remember back to those times. And hopefully in those times, you found peace in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the only place that we can find peace. This gospel that we have, we believe, brings peace in the middle of the storm. It's good news even whenever we hear bad news. And we can trust it and we can believe it. I would encourage us as families, husbands and wives, sons and daughters, to make our homes a place where peace abounds. I love home, and that's the thing about home. Is that when you go home, you can relax, take a load off. There's not all the chaos and craziness. Mom and dad, grandma and grandpa, make sure your home is a place full of peace. Amen. We don't need screaming and chaos and just things going crazy all the time. We need to have a peaceful home. That's emblematic of the faith and the peace that we find in Jesus Christ. Two more. Noah also picked up and put on this helmet of salvation. Now, Noah obviously had no knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ at this point, who ultimately is our salvation, right? But he and his family needed salvation from the Lord as well. Noah was focused on the salvation of his family. Are you? Noah was willing to do some crazy stuff. To build a boat, to do things that were countercultural so that his family would be saved. And he did it. Are you even concerned about the salvation of your family? This Thanksgiving holiday, as we are coming around people that we know, love, friends and family, some people that we really don't like a whole lot, we know that there are people in our families that need the Lord Jesus Christ. And instead of our posture being, well, let me just kind of stay away from them and let's just kind of grin and bear it for a few hours on Thanksgiving lunch, maybe we need to have conversations with our family. Amen. I'm not proposing that you go up to somebody and just straight up ask them if they know Jesus, but I'm also not proposing that you don't do that either. I would tell you to pray. And ask Jesus to give you opportunities to speak to your family about the Lord, about Jesus. Are you concerned about the salvation of your family, especially your immediate family? Think about it. We must do all that we can to ensure that our family members understand and embrace the truth of Jesus. Last but not least, Noah was obedient to God's word. And in doing so, he utilized the sword of the Spirit that we find in Ephesians 6. Noah didn't have the Bible like we do today, but he was obedient to God's spoken word if you read in Genesis. And that is a lesson for us. Let me ask you, and this is where I'm gonna get up in our Kool-Aid a little bit today if I haven't already done it. You ready? What does God's word tell us a healthy family structure looks like? I'm going to flow through real quick a few little scripture references. They're not going to be up there, Joe, so don't worry about these. But in Hebrews 13:4, the writer of Hebrews tells us to honor marriage and to keep the marriage bed pure. Now, this isn't popular in our culture. What does that mean? That means that there should be no sexual relationship outside of traditional marriage. Now, we preach that to our kids a lot, and our teenagers and those that are young, and as we should. But listen, that goes for everybody. Some of us are on relationships that are our second marriage, third marriage. We just got out of a relationship. I'm not here to judge you on that. That's between you and the Lord. But I would tell you that even as you're pursuing another marriage, possibly, this still applies to you.
Yes, sir.
It got quiet.
No.
Like, we don't outgrow this, okay? Well, I'm just old, so we can live together, we can shack up together, do all this kind of thing. No! That's not what it says. Again, I'm not judging you. I'm just telling you what the word says, that we should honor marriage. And when we don't do those things, then we're not honoring marriage. Also, just prior to the armor of God in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 5, the Apostle Paul talks a little bit about what a healthy family structure looks like. He says, hey, it's going to be based on a couple things, mutual respect and obviously love. In Ephesians 5:25, husbands are called to love their wives as Christ loved the church. That's a big deal, because you know what Christ did for his church? He died for the church. He went to crazy extremes to save his church, to save all of us, to protect all of us. And so that is the example that we as husbands and men have in front of us. We shouldn't take that lightly. Similarly, in verse 22 and 24 in Ephesians chapter 5, wives are encouraged to do what? Anybody know? Submit to their husbands. Now, this is. I did a wedding one time. I may have told you the story before. I'm going to tell you again. I had a bride that I had that in my wedding ceremony. That's part of what the Bible says. You ask me to do a wedding ceremony, I'm going to read the Bible to you. If you don't want me to do it, that's fine. You can find somebody else. But it said, wives, submit to your husband. And the bride didn't like it very much. She asked me if I could change it. I was like, well, I can read a different version. So I just changed it to, wives, be subject to your husband's leadership. And she liked that better. It's the same thing. Same exact thing. For some reason, we have an issue with that. And we can spend a lot of time talking about why that is. But in no way is Paul telling husbands to be domineering and to be bossy or any of those things over their wives. He's not saying that. We should lead husbands in a way that makes our wives want to trust us and want to follow our lead. If you have a hard time doing that as or finding that as a husband, maybe you're not leading right. We love wives. We love the women. We're so blessed to have them in our lives. But God has very specific roles carved out for husbands and wives. He just does. He also tells us, Paul does in Ephesians 6, that children should obey their parents and that fathers should not provoke their children but bring them up in the Lord's discipline and instruction. This is what God says the family unit, the family structure should look like. That's what it says. It's a challenge to us because we may not always see ourselves fitting into this. But if we want to live by the word of God and we want to win the battle for our families, we must put ourselves inside of this and ask ourselves, are we living in such a way in our families that God is pleased? Here's what I'm going to do as we close this morning. I want to challenge you with something. I want to challenge you to think about what it is you're actually doing in your family right now. You know, whenever we're in war and we have no clear goal or plan, that leads to frustration amongst soldiers and also amongst those of us that are back home. We've been involved in some of these long wars, right? Overseas, there's not clear objectives, and those things feel endless. They cause just demoralization. For you and your family, I think it's important that you have clear goals and clear objectives that provide direction, motivation, and shows you if you're making progress or not. In war talk, objectives are pretty common, right? They mean that there are specific things that armies are trying to get accomplished and trying to get done. These goals are key because they guide how the army fights and what they focus on. So today I want to give you some ideas for some family objectives for you and your family. And I'll just speak for my family. So maybe you can adopt these. Maybe they look different for you and your family. Whatever the case may be, I want to encourage you to think about what you're doing in your family. Are you just existing? Are you just living? Or are you actually trying to accomplish something? The first family objective that I would have for my family is that I want my family to know Jesus and each of them to have their own faith. Amen. That's objective number one for me. The second one would be church. I want my family to regularly attend church and to grow our family's faith in the larger family that is the body of Christ here at our church. Check it out. God designed this such a way that our smaller families would come be a part of a larger family. You don't have everything you need in your small family to be able to raise your kids in a way that they will turn out in the way that you want them to turn out. That's why you have the family of God, because in this family, there are people who can help with that. How many of you know sometimes if you can't get through to your kid, there's somebody else that can? And that person may be in this big body, this big family. The next thing I want my family to do, I want us to respect and care for each other. I want us to have a good relationship 30 years from now. I want us to treat each other with kindness and respect. I want to build strong and lasting relationships. I want us to be close now, and I want us to be close later on. And some of you, you don't find yourself there right now, but you can change that. It may take a while, but commit to that and see that through. Three more. I want my family to have a positive influence on the world. I want my family to make a difference everywhere that we are. Whether my kids are at school, we're out in the community doing something, I want my family to have a positive influence. The next objective for me is I want us to spend quality time together and prioritize that. And lastly, I want our long-term objective, our goal, to be to build a legacy. I want us to continue, in my case, a godly legacy. For some of you, it may be to create a godly legacy for future generations. That is a goal and an objective. Last but not least, we close with a very familiar verse. A guy by the name of Joshua puts it in such a way that only he could. So instead of me trying to close with something, I'm just going to read to you what he said. Joshua, who was the leader of the people of Israel as they took over the promised land, these folks began worshiping false gods. And Joshua turned around, looked them straight in the face, and said this in verse 14. So fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshiped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods of your ancestors serve beyond the Euphrates, or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you live now? But as for me and my family, what? We will serve the Lord. We bow our head and close our eyes today. That is the question that we're challenged with. Are we as a family serving the Lord? Are we fighting? Are we fighting the good fight? Or are we just existing? What is the purpose of our family? God, there are people in this room this morning who need to reevaluate their family and reevaluate what they're doing, their priorities, where they sit currently. And God, I pray right now that we would begin to have the kind of mentality in the mind that would lead us to fight for our families and to fight for the family structure that your word tells us we need. And I pray for those of us this morning who find ourselves in difficult situations with our families. Maybe there are things that have gone on in the past. Maybe we've made a mistake. And it's distanced us from our family, and it's caused harm and caused a lot of hurt over the years. And quite possibly, maybe even we're estranged from our family. God, today I pray for that person, God, in this Thanksgiving holiday, that you would work in their lives, that you would begin to renew their hope and to show them there is a path forward, that everything is still in front of them. And God, they would begin to do their part in reclaiming their family and begin being the kind of people, the kind of leaders that you want. God, maybe somebody in this room, a man or a woman, they don't have any ability to do this right now because they don't know you, Jesus. They don't have any idea who you are. So today, you are calling them to yourself. You want them to trust you today for the first time. You have shown us, and it's worked for so many thousands of years, what a good, godly family looks like. But God, we can only do that with your help, and we need your help. So God, there are people in this room this morning who want to give their life to you for the first time. They want to come home today. God, I pray that that would happen, that they would ask you in their life right now where they sit. Father, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand.